the death of the king was announced to us yesterday morning, there struck a deep and somber note in our lives.
We all know the scale of the challenge that faces us. We have a new sovereign, young, and a woman. Let us give her a coronation that is befitting of the wind of change that she represents.
When I was writing the coronation, I suddenly thought to myself, what's a more interesting way of doing this? So I staged most of the coronation at a sort of TV watching party in Paris.
The coronation as a live piece of television became this spectacular event, and as a result, we tell the story of the coronation through the process of televising it. So our world had to match, in some ways, the archive world, so that you could be able to cut between archive footage and our footage and not know the difference.
Long live Queen Elizabeth.
Every possible angle to everything has been thought about, and everyone is so meticulous at their job and so brilliant at their job.
We weren't able to use Westminster Abbey, so we thought Ely Cathedral has a similar kind of scale, at least. We allowed our audience to see more of the cathedral than the audience of 1953 were allowed to see Westminster Abbey. You know, there was an awful lot of covering up going on. There was an awful lot of things built, slabby things built, that actually hid the integrity of the architecture in order to turn it into this television event. So I sort of met that halfway in a way. Philip Martin and I were keen to see that being built, and so we saw it structurally happening, you know, with scaffolding inside the shell of Ely Cathedral. The coronation chair was recreated absolutely to the letter. It's the one that has this vast stone of scone underneath it, but the chair itself was recreated to the letter, all of that sort of worn gilding.
Action!
There's so much pomp and circumstance and specific costumes and specific people who play a formal function within the coronation service, and so Michelle's costumes had to match the archive footage.
The coronation dress was one of the very few we didn't make. It was actually made for an exhibition by Swarovski. In this instance, it was screen printed and then the jewels were heat set. The original would have been embroidered. We were so fortunate that actually it fitted our queen.
And now we come to the anointing. The single most holy, most solemn, most sacred moment, the entire service.
She's anointed by God and there by the grace of God. In the moment of her coronation, it was decided that moment was too holy to be filmed, and the screens went blank during the TV broadcast.
Where'd she go?
She's been told that when she becomes queen, she will be the embodiment of God on this earth. And when she takes those sacred rites with the Archbishop of Canterbury, she is essentially talking to God. She ceases from that point to be herself. She is now someone else.
We get to glimpse what looks like just a bit of ceremony. This series allows us to glimpse what goes on within the ceremony, the kind of emotional intricacy of it, I suppose. That, for me, is when it's really alive.
God save the Queen!
Well, welcome. And that was just to remind us how much we loved the crown when we saw it last autumn, and also a little bit of the why we loved it so much. And that's what the discussion this evening is really about, how they pulled it off, how probably the most ambitious thing British television ever did worked so well. I'm Andrew Billen. I'm the TV critic on the Times, and I'm delighted to welcome a panel of jewels from Netflix's Crown. And first, a huge welcome to the prime mover of the whole thing, Peter Morgan. Peter, one of the leading scriptwriters of our time, particularly on dramas based on fact, acclaimed for The Queen, Frost Nixon, the play The Audience in the West End. Peter created The Crown, he wrote the first 10 episodes, and he will write, we hope and trust and pray, another 50, bringing us right through to the coronation of King Charles III, perhaps.
And the assassination. And then William.
That's going to be a terrific series 10, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm in.
Suzanne Mackie is The Crown's executive producer, creative director of Left Bank Pictures, which makes The Crown. You made your mark, I think, on things like Mad Dolls, Calendar Girls, and Kinky Boots. And there's Philip Martin, the Emmy Award-winning director and producer, who's an executive producer of The Crown, directed four episodes, including Smoke and Mirrors, the coronation episode that we're going to kind of look at in some detail over the next hour and a bit. Martin Childs, an Oscar-winning production designer, whose credits include The Crying Game and Shakespeare in Love. Martin created the sumptuous look of the series, and not just sumptuous, some of the sort of the dowdy bits as well, which are interesting.
You can do dowdy. And,
I can do dowdy.
And finally, one of my favourite actors, Alex Jennings, who, as the Duke of Windsor, came nearer than anybody to actually wearing that crown. Who's a complete spiff. Right, some complicated stuff now. I'd like to welcome everybody who's watching on us on the Royal Television Society Facebook page. And if you out there have got a question you'd like to ask, please comment on that page on Facebook or tweet us on hashtag RTS The Crown. It's up there for the viewers at home. Marvellous. So, Peter, before we zoom in on that coronation... Oh, it's live stream. That makes all the difference. Before we live stream, before we live stream in our heads that coronation episode, could we just talk a bit more generally about it? I mean, you had written the Queen, you'd done the audience. Why did you want to go back to the House of Windsor again?
Well, I got very, I really enjoy writing scenes between, I'm not a queen nutter or anything. I mean, I really want to just say that. I particularly enjoyed, in the movie, in the film The Queen, I particularly enjoyed writing the scenes between her and Tony Blair. And I don't know why, I just loved the private audience. As soon as we were behind the closed doors in that audience room, it's just a dramatist's dream, and I feel very fortunate that I got there first. And I'm sure other dramatists were like, why didn't I think of that? That's such a wonderful thing to write about. And so I then explored it more in the audience. And in the course of writing the audience, when I was writing the scene between her and Churchill, I suddenly thought, well, this is just a wonderful relationship. And a young girl in her mid-20s and a man in his, early 70s. And they were, they had so many delicious differences. And yet they were thrown in together. And she's very much at the beginning of her career. He's this extraordinary, international statesman. And yet he was in awe of her. There were so many wonderful contradictions, he was much frailer than he ever imagined. I thought, well, this is just a sensational relationship.
And this is stuff you don't get out of history books. You have to use your dramatist's imagination.
Yeah, I mean, but then people stumble upon things all the time and you sort of go, well, that's just such a wonderful story. Whether it inspires you to write fiction or indeed write, a fact-based drama based on that stuff. I mean, I started writing this stuff, and that was my original thought, was that this would be a film. And then I kept doing this thing about, it's really important when you write, I always struggle to find what the beginning is. What is the beginning? What's the beginning of the story? And I ask myself that again and again and again and again and again, much more than the endings. I'm really concerned, how do you start this? Where does this start? And with The Queen, I kept thinking, well, it starts when she meets Churchill, but then in order for her to meet Churchill, her father needs to die. Yeah. And then for order her father to die, she needs to get married. Yeah. And then I suddenly thought, well, hang on a minute. This is a messy first act. And it was really just by going backwards and thinking, well, where does this damn thing start? That I ended up thinking, well, hang on, this might actually have longer legs and be something that's more appropriate for television.
So you really thought it could be a two-hour movie, the first season?
Well, no, not the first season. My original instinct was to do this as a film and just to have it about the relationship between Churchill, the young Elizabeth and Winston Churchill. Yeah. Just because, we never see him old and we never see her young. And so I suddenly thought, well, Churchill's always in the war years. And this was such, there were so many interesting things about his strokes, his frailty, and also the way in which he behaved towards her. I mean, he used her to prolong his time in office. Mm. I just thought, ooh, this is good. Yeah.
And are facts, historical facts, your friend here? Because I hear you don't have a writer's room. You have a room for the researchers.
I do, yeah. Yeah. I do. Wonderful people, really. And some, you know, some have been with me quite a long time. And I think, you know, I think the traditional thing with a drama like this is, you know, with a show like this, is that you have a room full of writers. And instead what I do is I map stuff out, and I like to come up with the ideas for the episodes. And then the researchers go away and they come back with material. So I'm never starting completely from scratch. I'm starting with, you know, really fleshed out ideas. And then I start to work, you know, once I say, can you just find out more? For example, someone said, you do know about the great fog of 1952. I said, no. And then I said to the researchers, find out about the great fog of 1952 for me. Yeah. And this beautiful sort of 3-page document came back. And I went, ooh, this is good. Yeah. And I thought, because I didn't know. And if the chances are you don't know.
Did the secretary die?
I'm not prepared to discuss
that. Let me put
Are
it
you on. Trying to get my secrets out of me, Admiral?
Let me put it another way. Did Prince Philip outstare an elephant?
Yes.
That happened?
Yeah. And also, Venetia, who was the secretary, she's a composite. Hmm. Or, I mean, clearly her relationship with the bus that killed her isn't a composite, but Churchill's affection for his secretaries, yeah, and not in a lecherous sense, but in a, you know, partly in a lecherous sense, but we had the Churchill estate to consider.
I was worried at one point.
Yes, you
with
thought
the
bath it was.
Scene, yeah.
You thought it was all going to go that way, but we didn't. But we didn't, took the high road.
Do that, yeah. Oh, I want to discuss the themes of the piece, and perhaps just to kick that off, we could have another little clip, which I think might help us. If it comes up, here we go.
Goodness, that's very heavy indeed.
£5, sir.
Not to mention the symbolic weight.
There's a sight I hoped I'd never see.
I mean, that's some of it, isn't it? How does any human being bear that weight?
Yeah, and it you know, well, she's borne it brilliantly. I mean, you know, and I come at this as someone who's really pretty, I don't have skin in the game with the role. You know, I came at this, I think, as we all did, you know, most sensible people, certainly in the early 90s, thought this lot should be kicked out. And there's something so extraordinary about how history has, you know, I think if we had a referendum on the royal family tomorrow, I think about 80% of the country would vote to keep them, at least.
How would you vote?
I'd vote to keep them. Yeah. I would. I really would. You look at the heads of state everywhere else. I think that there's just been such a collective, catastrophic failure of the political class in the last couple of years. And the stability, I think, that she... you know, but that was a struggle that her father, you know, I think depends on the monarch is the answer, really, isn't it? And we happen to have someone who's pretty damn good at it.
But it kind of killed her dad.
It did, yes. Yeah. That's why I say I think it depends on the monarch. I think that the Duke of Windsor might not have made a particularly good king.
Alex will bring the defence in.
But we'd have ended up with the Queen anyway.
Yes.
Yes.
True. Childless.
He might have been marvellous.
Did writing it for Netflix change the way you wrote it? It strikes me that every episode is like a movie. It's got a final scene and it's satisfying in itself rather than a sort of cliffhanger. Is that a factor?
Well, but we can mess around with that. I mean, you know, I think some of the time, I mean, the short answer, that's such a high, I'd love to answer that in so many different ways, but the short answer is they're fantastic. And I don't say that because they pay my bills. They are genuinely, they completely leave us alone, and they support what we're doing. What I loved about it was when I, as entering it, I was particularly excited to do it with Netflix because I didn't know who they were really, and I didn't know what they were doing. All I knew was that they were changing things, and I think all of us don't quite know what they're doing. Or what the effect of streaming is having on the ways in which we're consuming narrative. And I do know that that allowed me to completely loosen up. And I now tell stories sometimes I run three episodes, one after the other, because the statistics show that people are watching, the average streamer is watching 2.5-3 hours at a time.
Gosh.
And so it makes sense to construct narratives in that way, but then I can't help myself occasionally constructing completely individual episodes that have nothing to do with a... And one thing I loathe is sort of story arcs across a season. Or I love things that make no sense, and you sort of think, oh, well, he's bound to follow up with that in the next episode. Yeah. We're going to get the cliff, you know, and then you go somewhere completely different.
And you get
different.
The fog.
Yeah. I mean, yes, the fog, or indeed the Graham Sutherland portrait.
No, that was a wonderful one.
Yeah. And
completely
that,
unexpected.
Completely unexpected. Yeah. And it just was like, oh, that sounds good. Let's do that. Yeah. And
it wasn't
and
really about the Queen, was it?
It wasn't. Yeah. It was about Churchill and mortality and just an intimate relationship between an artist and a subject.
You know. Suzanne, when did this project come to you? When did Left Bank get involved?
Well, I mean, I was been working at Left Bank for about probably more like 3 or 4 years. And Andy Harris, who runs Left Bank Pictures, Peter's relationship go way back. I mean, they have a great lineage of work with each other, and it's a very particular body of work, I'd say. And so from someone who hadn't worked at Left Bank, I was always very impressed with that body of work and that particular voice. So when Andy mentioned something called The Audience, which was going to be a play at the West End, it was a complete departure, I mean, nothing to do with Left Bank Pictures, and yet I could see in Andy something that was making him excited in the way that I hadn't seen him excited for a long, long time. And it wasn't just about working with Peter again, it was a particular subject matter. It was something that felt vital to him. It possibly belonged to a zeitgeist that maybe we weren't even aware of at the time. And then coupled with that, it was Stephen Daldry directing. And I thought, gosh, this is fantastic, actually. I want to see this, whether I'm tangentially involved in it or not.
Well, a sort of televisation of the audience.
No, I don't think any of us thought that at the time.
Something more?
Yeah, I just thought they'd got something really interesting. And a combination of voices and people involved. Helen, of course, Stephen Daldry, Peter, Andy. I thought, oh, that's fantastic. And then Andy just won. I think Andy and Peter had started to talk about this with Robert Fox and Byron Shaw about the possibility of it being a television piece. And I read the first script, which was at that point a 2-hour script, episode 1 and 2. And I was bowled over by it. I thought it was extraordinary. And I realised what was extraordinary was that Peter wanted to tell the story right back at a very early stage in The Queen is a Princess, the reluctant Queen, and take us on a very important journey, the second half of the 20th century and into our history, what we're existing, going through now. And I just, it was irresistible.
That's a huge project, isn't it, to get involved?
Yeah, don't keep saying that.
One step at a time.
It's so exhausting.
I know it is. It does. It feels like you're climbing a mountain. You climb one mountain and then you think, that's great, we've done it, we've got to the summit and down again. And there's another mountain to climb, and it's huge. And the endeavour is huge, but it's also deeply satisfying.
So why an American streaming company rather than a British network?
I think, as Peter said, it felt the unknown. It felt
it felt liberating. It felt their boldness in the they bought it in the room. That in itself was bold and brave and big. And they said,
so you
no
flew
notes.
To Hollywood and they
said, yeah. And we thought probably the BBC would be part of it or ITV. We didn't know how it was going to be constructed and structured. And you know, in the end, what you want as a producer and as for the writer and for the director, and you want to walk in and feel that passion and that confidence in what you're pitching, that vision. And they shared it, they had it. And I remember Andy phoning up and saying, I think we've just sold it to Netflix. Mm. And it was sort of brilliant because, yeah.
There are different cycles in companies at different times, aren't there? And companies have their own, and sometimes people are cautious. They've had a bad year, they've had a good year, they've just had an executive reshuffle. And you go in at a particular time into a particular company. And we happened to walk into Netflix at the moment where they were flush with confidence from having just made House of Cards, and they had a mandate that was to push internationally. Mm. And at the precise moment, I think that they had just sat amongst themselves and said, you know what, we think we should go international with this. I plunked in and said, hello, I'd like to do a story about this. And they were like, oh, well, that fits. And so they just went, let's do it. And normally people are very cautious. Yeah. And
you come away insecure, and you don't. We didn't.
And they put the money behind it, so it looks like cinema, doesn't it?
Yeah, and that's what we wanted.
Think there's something about the way that it's delivered to people that has transformed the nature of the story itself, in the sense that everybody on the planet who wants to watch The Crown can watch The Crown, and anybody on the planet who doesn't want to watch The Crown doesn't have to watch The Crown. So people come to it wanting to watch it and having created time in their life to watch it. So what they want is singularity and authenticity and originality and a different voice. And so I think that allows you to do something different. And however wonderful the TV schedules are, if you're making something for a schedule where you have to deliver a particular show at 9 o'clock on Sunday evening, that means that it needs to be a certain kind of thing. There are certain things that you can discuss, there are certain things that you can't, there are certain things that you can show. There's a format to it that's already, that it has to kind of park itself into. Mm. Whereas this, I think there was a freedom in the format to discover the thing, in a way, for Peter to find it, for us to find it, and to sort of explore something that just had to be, if you like, original and interesting and singular. And there's something about that that's very special, I think. Mm.
It looks so different. It sounds different. That very first episode with the C word in, when I was watching it in a viewing theatre,
exactly.
I thought, this...
I'm
not an award-winning dramatist. I can't get away with it. But I thought, this is different. Let's sort of zoom in a bit on the coronation episode and see another clip, please.
Do not overstep the mark.
And I made it clear, carte blanche or nothing at all.
Trade unionists and businessmen in the Abbey.
If you want to stay on the throne, yes.
In a trimmed-down, televised coronation.
If you want to avoid a revolution, yes, you forget. I have seen firsthand what it is like for a royal family to be overthrown because they're out of step with the people. I left Greece in an orange crate. My father would have been killed. My grandfather was. I'm just trying to protect you.
From whom? The British people? You have no idea who they are or what they want.
Oh, I'm just Johnny Foreigner again, who doesn't understand. Fine. You want a big overblown ceremony costing a fortune while the rest of the country is on rations? Have it. But don't come bleating to me when your head and the heads of our children are on spikes.
If the people are hungry, they want something that lifts them up.
And how do you propose lifting them if they cannot see?
The people look to the monarchy for something bigger than themselves, an inspiration, a higher ideal. If you put it in their homes, allow them to watch it with their dinner on their laps.
Democratize it. Make them feel that they share in it. Understand it.
All right. Right. I'll support you in the televising.
You won't regret it.
On one condition. That you kneel.
Told you.
My Prime Minister. He said you intended to refuse.
confused. No, I merely asked the question whether it was right in this day and age that the Queen's consort, her husband, should kneel to her rather than stand beside her.
He won't be kneeling to me.
That's not how it will look. That's not how it will feel. It will feel like a eunuch. An amoeba is kneeling before his wife.
You'll be kneeling before God and the crown, as we all do.
I don't see you kneeling before anyone.
I'm not kneeling because I'm already flattened under the weight of this thing.
Oh, spare me the false humility. Doesn't look like that to me.
How does it look to you?
It looks to me like you're enjoying it. It's released an unattractive sense of authority and entitlement that I have never seen before.
And in you, it's released a weakness, an insecurity I've never seen before.
Are you my wife or my queen?
I'm both.
I want to be married to my wife.
I am both, and a strong man will be able to kneel to both.
I will not kneel before my wife.
But your wife is not asking you to.
But my queen commands me.
Yes.
I beg you, make an exception for me.
No.
Wasn't that good? So Philip, the stakes were high in 1953 about filming this coronation. Did you feel the stakes very high for you as you directed that episode?
Yes. just because everybody has seen it in a way, and it was the, I think it was the, it was one of the world's first big televised events. So it was something that was in the public consciousness, and there were lots of images from it that people were familiar with, and so we had to make deliver our version of it in a way that felt satisfying and authentic and real to the story that we were telling, but also didn't feel like it was a cheat or that somehow we'd done it either unrealistically or untruthfully.
Because you got the intimacy, didn't you, sort of in that scene, but you also get the grandeur.
Yes, yes. Well, we sort of did a complicated thing where we filmed in a bit of Ely Cathedral and we built a bit of Ely Cathedral, as though for Westminster Cathedral in Pinewood, and then we kind of created. We used existing archive on the televisions, the televisation of the event, but also we created fake archive with our characters in it, and then we mixed up real archive and fake archive, and it was all actually lots and lots of technique, lots of directing, lots of design, and just trying to come at the problem in a way that we would create a seamless sense of being there, and this brilliant idea that Peter had to tell the story through the televisation of it, but also in some ways to tell the story dramatically and emotionally through the Duke of Windsor who hadn't got the crown, and so you were kind of exploring what it means to be crowned by the absence of it, and it just felt like such an interesting and original way to do it. There's one person, the Queen, who's coming at the job, wondering what it involves, and there's another person who's looking at it and thinking what they lost. And in some ways it was that combination of the two joint positions that created this sort of bittersweet feeling about it, so that it's not only a celebration but a kind of loss in some ways, and it's that stopped it being syrupy in a way and yet made it truthful.
But it's actually quite tense, isn't it? The moment of coronation itself, and especially when Philip doesn't it? I'm looking for that forgiving moment from her.
Yeah, yeah.
And did you say to Claire Foy, just keep the face?
I think so. In a way, it doesn't take very many notches on the dial because this show is so steeped in that world. I think you have to direct it in an unsentimental way and not go for the easy moment, and in some ways trust in the story and trust in the writing to keep it quite not austere but quite not too warm sometimes or not too easy. Not warm, I think, is the wrong word, but it should be emotional but not easy, and in some ways they won't, as characters, have a private, won't broadcast this moment between them. So it is, if you look at the real footage of the coronation, of course there's a ton of stuff going on between them, but it's very buried, and so in a way they're not the kind of people who would use a public event to sort of showcase their emotions for each other. And so in some ways, you have to keep truthful to who the characters are and to the situation. And that helps everything, actually.
And Martin, you designed this entirely fake cathedral, did you?
We weren't given permission to use Westminster Abbey.
We did ask.
And
they said we'd rather not.
We went to they prefer not to welcome us. Yeah. And we went to Ely Cathedral, which is the next best thing, and it proved, I think, to be a better thing because it's much more graphic and clean. You can empty out Ely Cathedral. Many years ago, I worked on a film called the first film I ever designed, called Mrs. Brown, and it had almost no budget at all. And we sort of discovered that the best way to show the richest woman in the world was to put this tiny little black figure in a vast space. And Ely Cathedral could do that in a way that that Westminster Abbey couldn't. Westminster Abbey's full of obstacles. I'd have spent a lot of time covering things up.
But that was sort of faked up itself, wasn't it? Fake pillars and places for the cameras to hide.
Mm. Oh, yes, 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 yes. We did. We made obvious their concealment of the cameras.
Yeah. So did you watch the entire Dimbleby broadcast before?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Was it well directed?
It was very well directed, actually. And actually, it's interesting how much, although I would say this, but it's interesting how much the actual director of the original TV show of the coronation shaped the actual our sense of who the royal family are. He thought, oh, it's a bit dull here, we better play some music, why don't we play I Vow to Thee My Country? Do you know what I mean? And he's in terms of what we think of as very royal things were actually created in the televising of it.
Because there's some bad faith there. They did do some close-ups, didn't they?
They did do some close-ups. Yeah, they said that the deal was that they would do the coronation, if they were allowed to do the coronation, they would do close-ups, and they had a kind of huge zoom lens and kind of sneakily did an enormous close-up. Yeah.
And then the other bit of story within that is, of course, Philip's decision to drive it towards televised in a bid to democratise the. Yeah, so there's another layer of story going on, which is.
And now you're showing it to the world.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
I mean, I keep thinking I've made it all up, but every single bit of this is true. I mean, I'd love to take more credit for it, but I can't. You know, the fact is, you know, I thought, oh my God, as soon as I heard that the Duke of Windsor, the man who'd never had a coronation. Mm-hmm. Was stuck in Paris and was watching with a party of American guests. It's like, how lovely is that? Yeah. And you sort of, you know, that clearly he then had to be talking people through it. You know, that was A, anecdotally that had been described by the hostess, and that when people were saying, who's that, he would tell, he stood up and sort of pointed out and said, oh, that's Mountbatten, and that's this, and that's
that. These days you'd be on Sky News, wouldn't you?
Yeah. And he got a fee, I think.
He did get a fee.
He did get a fee.
It was a paid gig.
Yeah, it was a gig.
It was a gig.
Yeah.
Isn't that fantastic?
So, Alex, were you actually watching on a small screen the footage, or...? How did you do that commentary?
No, Alex is amazing because this is the very, very first day that we shot. Alex was doing.
Did we not have some of the?
He was doing
footage?
Good acting, and he was
pretending.
You were pretending that the coronation had been filmed when it hadn't been. Yeah. So very good.
Shall we have a brief look at that? I think we've got some footage of those moments.
fantastic moment, isn't it?
Yeah.
But incidentally, Mark, was that archived? Was that fake? Was
so
that
that's interesting. That's a good example of a bit of everything. Yeah. So that's the real footage of the Queen coming down out of down the aisle towards us. But then we've combined our Queen in with the existing archive. So the people on the left and the right of the aisle are the people who are in the cathedral at that time. And then the column of people coming towards us in the middle is our lot. So it's a mix, yeah.
So, Alex, how was it to play the black sheep of the family?
Well, you do a lot. I became sort of quite obsessed with him, them, really. And I have to be careful of being sort of a bit of a champion of him, because people have very strong
views. Of
this
proto-Nazi.
Yeah. Yeah, but, you know. Only proto. And it's really complicated. You know, he had a fairly active First World War. Mm. He was out there, and his driver was killed in the car that he happened not to be in at the time, and wanted to be more involved, and was quite sort of radical politically and a worry to the establishment. And I think sort of acted with huge integrity in a way when he said, unless you can accommodate this woman, I'm off.
And it's a very romantic story.
Yeah, and he was off. And I think he was, as far as he was concerned, I think it was a huge passion.
And a very principled one.
Yeah, yeah, and he didn't sway from that.
And there was a large constituency of people that pushed him out.
Yeah.
So
yeah. They didn't really want to.
Yeah. You could argue for good reason, but they did. The establishment was hostile.
Mm. But it's kind of true to the slogan of the series: the crown always wins, isn't it? And he was on a hiding to nothing when fighting that establishment.
Mm. And then just sort of floated for the rest of his life.
Mm. I mean, he's a very fantastically witty figure in
yeah, I mean, all the letters are extraordinary.
Yeah.
Oh, is that all true? The terrible names you gave the Queen Mum.
Yeah, wonderful.
He made those nicknames up. I wish I was as good. I wish I was as good. Yeah, Cookie, good is that?
And
so great.
And Shirley Temple. Yes. But it doesn't necessarily mean he was a completely bad person. and he did, when he came back, when Queen Mary was dying, he spent more time with her than his surviving brother and his sister did. It's sort of documented. So I think there's, you know, you can also be writing scurrilous, vicious things about the person and also be having kind of tender moments with them.
Absolutely. And the feeling of loss he experiences from not having had that moment in the cathedral.
And you see, look at the pictures of the house they had in Paris, which they didn't pay much rent for. And it's stuffed full of king memorabilia. You know, the abdication table, his red box that he had his papers with king written on it, banners that he shouldn't have had with him. She had jewellery that she shouldn't have had. They were living this sort of weird, weird life, sort of lost.
Perhaps I can ask the audience, how many of you know, do any of you know, who bought, I'm sure some of you know, who bought the Duke of Windsor's house
after he died,
in order to get that memorabilia? Yep. Yes.
Yeah. No, really.
Muhammad Al-Fayed.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And restored the house and took his valet.
Yeah. Sidney Johnson took his valet straight after his death. He had his valet. Fantastic.
But it's a very useful role, a very useful commentary to have there for the Republicans amongst us watching it to see the cynicism and the piss taking, wasn't it?
Well, yeah, but also, you know, underneath all that, the desperate wanting, in the case of Al-Fayed, to get British citizenship and the lengths to which he was prepared to get it.
And where it then ultimately leads.
They'll give it to me if I'm father-in-law to that king.
Yeah.
So has anybody said to you, Alex, like, you have rehabilitated the Duke of Windsor for me?
No, they've not said that.
But you have to sort of, you know, you try and get inside the head of that
They
person.
Have said that. I'm sorry, they have said that. Yeah, they've said it perhaps less politely than that. They've said that we've a couple of people have written that we've given the Duke of Windsor too easy a path. And they haven't seen season two yet. They jumped too soon.
Yeah.
I suppose we would think, most of us would say that the great rehabilitation, if it was needed, was of Philip, who comes over with under Matt Smith as an incredibly attractive and vital force.
Do you think?
Yeah.
Oh, good.
You sound surprised.
Because I think, you know, he's a strong flavour, and I find him extraordinarily interesting, and it's his childhood. You just couldn't make it up.
He was the character that leapt out most in the first script Peter wrote. I remember being most surprised by that character. I thought, gosh, you could have easily created a slightly one-dimensional stereotype that we poke fun at. And actually, no, he'd imbued with character with humanity and an energy and a vitality and a love of life and a progressor and someone modernising and thinking. And that was a genuine surprise to me and revelation. And I thought, if we could somehow capture that spirit in the adaptation, then
and season two is really the soul of season two is his complexity, I think.
Yeah. So we all want to know, does he have an affair?
Everybody in Britain knows he has.
Do you dramatise it?
I'm not. This is a spoiler-free chat we're having.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't want to spoil your fun, or indeed. In fact, we're still in the cutting room. We're still making all sorts of decisions.
So but you're what, 7 months into filming?
How long have we been filming? 6 months.
Six months.
Since
October. Yeah, and we still have quite a long way to go. Mm. It really isn't like television anymore. No. It's absolutely. It's really quite overwhelming. You know, it's partly also the way in which we make it. It's not like television, and every time we get an opportunity to make it like television, I keep saying, please, can we resist this? Because, you know, we're trying to do something that is, I think that just a combination of facts, the way people are watching now, the way they want to watch, the way they're, for better or for worse, slightly drifting away from cinema, the technology that people have means that they're so much more comfortable watching at home, controlling their own environment, watching when they want, how they want. And just now we have the technology to, you know, not just with streaming, but also with the televisions and the sound and everything, to really enjoy extraordinary, you know. And I think the Crown is only the first tiny step. I think if we jump forward 5, 10, 15, 20 years, it'll be absolutely normal to have our show will be considered a complete peanut show, a low-budget nonsense. The you know...
I think Suzanne doesn't quite believe this.
No, it's really true. It's really true. I think the future will be that there'll be day and date. I mean, that's a terrible expression, but I believe it means on the same day and at the same time, you go in all the countries at the same time. So we went out in... It became available for us to go out in 190 countries on the same day. Mm. And most of these countries don't have proper broadband reach yet. A lot of them don't. Mm. And many people haven't got the subscriber base that Netflix would or would want. But I think it's only a matter of time before that subscriber base grows, the broadband reach and the grows, and streaming will grow and grow and grow and grow and grow. It's just how it's going to be.
So things will get bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah, well, they will. If you're opening to 190 countries on the same day, you don't have a regional, national audience to address anymore. You're talking about global event television.
But the danger is a course thing then, isn't there? But you've got to make sure, all of you have got to make sure it remains intimate and satirical and specific.
Oh, this is way beyond our time. I think the Crown will be what the Crown is. I'm saying that I think in the future, the Star Wars, the Bonds, we'll be watching those across 10 hours. I think that the storytelling will change. The size of television productions will change. There will always, of course, there'll always be room for cinema, but I believe in this as a paradigm.
It's interesting. A few years ago, everyone was talking about tiny concentration spans and the 6-minute culture, and now here we are, box set culture, I mean, I saw a documentary on OJ, and that came out 7.5 hours.
You know? How good was that?
It was fantastic.
It was fantastic.
Yeah, like the best documentary ever, because it had time.
But it was as good as the subject was big. Mm. The documentary earned those 8 hours of your time.
Mm. And we didn't know, we genuinely didn't know whether people would maybe dip into one or two episodes, whether they'd stay with us from 1 to 10. We really... one hopes, but...
And do we know the evidence of whether they watched...
Well, only anecdotally, yeah. People telling us that they sat and watched one and then they felt compelled to watch the next, so suddenly between us all, we were all able to, in those early weeks of November when it first dropped or launched or whatever it does, you know, people were saying, actually, I've already got to episode 10 and it's day 2, and you think, gosh, really? That's wonderful, that's brilliant. We didn't. You never know.
Philip, which episodes are you doing in the next season?
I'm doing the first three, and which all group together as a story, as one long story. So, yeah.
Is this Suez flowing through Mrs. Eden's drawing room?
It's Suez and exactly. Suez and the fallout and Macmillan.
A challenge for the set designer.
I'm doing all 10.
Yes. Do we see Suez then?
We see lots of Suez, wow. Yes. I mean, we spent quite a bit of time in Cape Town and South Africa finding bits of Suez and bits of all sorts of other places. You practically did a world tour
Africa. Philip goes on a world tour.
Mm. Except for Antarctica, where you shot it in Tring.
Yes, Antarctica was in Tring.
Not even Leighton Buzzard.
It was Leighton Buzzard plus Huskies.
We had penguins.
But we had Team GB Huskies.
Yeah.
See, I've occasionally met people who said, I don't want to watch it, I'm not that interested in the Royals. Mm. But of course, it's just our history, isn't it? It's political history as much as.
I'm not interested in the Royals, so I completely understand. I know, but it's not that. It's more to do with what it is to be us and what it is to live in our times and what it is to. I think I find myself getting emotional watching the show sometimes, and it's not that I particularly care about this woman's life or indeed her marriage, or you know, it is the fact that. Through her, I'm connected to my grandparents. Mm-hmm. Through her, I'm connected to my parents. She is the sort of the sinew that connects us all on the deepest subconscious level. And and that in some way...
Have you ever dreamt about her?
Well, they say all British men have.
That's not a denial.
So maybe I haven't. Maybe I haven't. And you'd think if anybody had, I probably would have by now. But you have an excuse. I don't remember. I don't know. It's not happened yet. I don't know.
Right, we're going to now see if we get you some even sillier questions from the audience. But to inspire us, one final clip, which I think sums up the series pretty well.
Who wants transparency when you can have magic? Who wants prose when you can have poetry? Pull away the veil, and what are you left with? An ordinary young woman of modest ability and little imagination. And wrap her up like this, anoint her with oil, and hey presto, what do you have? A goddess.
I mean, there you are. It's absurd, it's cruel, it's fake, and it's utterly magnificent, isn't it, at the same time? Yeah. Right, questions, please. We've got some from the Twitter sphere as well. If you just put a hand up and
right there.
You talked a little bit about how you get from facts to dramatisation. I know a lot of people, when they watch it, thinking, oh, did this really happen? And you've explained that a little bit. Do you ever think about the characters that are still alive when you're writing it? For example, the exchanges between the Queen and the Duke. Would they ever watch it? I assume no one knows what they would have done, but what they would think, or people thinking, no, it didn't happen like that. Or do you just escape that feeling and just let it, you know, how do you escape that feeling?
There are about nine questions in there. I think as I can recall the questions, you sort of, first of all, maybe they've seen it, maybe they haven't. I don't want to know if possible, and I want them to be able to deny what they want, and I want them to have their independence. And it helps me to not know what their responses are. In terms of the verisimilitude, I do think that every time I think I've made something up, it turns out. I mean, it's so much more accurate than I thought. I've always tried to get it to be truthful, but I always think it's not going to be accurate because I wasn't there, I don't know, and so forth. But actually, I've now been fed so much research. And actually, things like in episode one, for example, I don't know if you remember, but when the king dies, an eagle comes when she's in Sagana Lodge. That's episode two, actually. And there really was one. And, you know, we wrote it intentionally, you know, the elephant that you asked, and so forth. So you do your best. And then there are occasionally moments in between two fixed points where you have to join the dots. And that's where I think the audience wants a dramatist to do that. You know, they don't just want, you know, a slavish recreation of this or that. They want an interpretation, and I think there's a covenant of understanding between an audience and a dramatist that you want a dramatist to do that, and you will reject it if you don't believe it.
But responsibility to living people?
A huge responsibility. Because the television, often what happens is the television, Tony Blair, when he talks about the audiences he has with the Queen in the days after Diana's death, I don't know whether I wrote lines that he actually said, but he certainly now, when describing it, quotes lines that were in the paper. Who got what right? I don't know. In Frost Nixon, I had to take a line, but when I spoke to all the people, all the researchers on both sides, there were very, very different versions of history going on for a whole load of people that were first-person witnesses to the actual events. And you have to pick a line, and I do try not to take sides. I do try to be, you know, you have your own conscience. In the end, it's a conscience. I try to stay sober and have a conscience. you have to write with a conscience. You know when you're fibbing.
Anybody else? Couple there? I don't know if you have a mic or just a strong voice. The mic is coming.
Hello. Thank you very much. Lovely programme. Netflix have very famously said that you don't hire Peter Morgan and tell him what to do, and that they have not given you too much influence. Can you compare... You've all worked with other studios and other broadcasters. Is there anything missing from them not getting involved and not telling you what to do?
No. I mean that in the nicest possible way. I mean that if we had a problem, we'd ring them. Yeah. And if the problem needed solving, but we're very lucky. We happen to have just fabulous people working on the show, so there are no personal conflicts. And it's a testimony to the producers and the production company that makes it. I can say that. Suzanne probably couldn't. That it runs really, really efficiently and well. We didn't overspend. And I think it really helps that they're American and this subject is so English that they don't feel they know better.
Yeah.
I think if we were writing about something that was set within their culture, I think they maybe... But I think they genuinely feel, right? So I think that helps. we can just go all sort of English on them and they'll go and they'll just shut up.
Lied them with the magic of it.
Yeah, we'll just, we'll start talking ridiculous nonsense.
Alex, Ali on Facebook asks, where did you film the Paris scenes?
The Paris scenes? Yeah. In a stately home off the M25. I can't remember which one.
RAF Halton.
Yeah. Is that what it was?
Mm, yeah.
And Elstree.
And on a soundstage.
Yeah, and on a soundstage at
Elstree. That got converted into the Queen's bedroom the week after we'd finished with it.
We didn't get to go to Paris, sadly.
Any other questions? Yes. This row is very active. Let's go to the row behind, chap at the end.
Mr. Jenkins, how did you get into the character? How did you transform into the person that we see in The Crown?
Well, my approach is that I read everything that's available and watch footage and try and absorb that. And then, with the help of Philip, I was sort of forced to let go of all that, really. I had, when we did the flashbacks when he's doing the abdication speech, which is the sort of, I suppose, the most famous audio recording there is of the Duke of Windsor, I kind of got that down pat, and was very proud of myself that I could do my impersonation of my Mike Yarwood version of the Duke of Windsor. And Philip just encouraged me to sort of let go of all that and not feel encumbered by trying to do an impersonation.
Do you think there were any external or internal influences at work, consciously or subconsciously? Mm.
I don't quite know what you mean.
Do you mean Russians?
things like the clothes help you. I'm quite shallow, but then so was he.
And it's collaborative, and I was very happy working with Philip and with Leah, who played Wallace. And felt secure, I suppose. But I don't know whether anything stranger than that was going on.
Another question. Oh, well. Just trying to find the lady at the back.
Thank you. I wondered whose decision it was in terms of broadcasting on Netflix. You can release all your episodes at once, or you can choose to release episode by episode, and I wondered whose decision that was, and if you could talk through your approach to that, because obviously it influences how people experience a TV show in terms of the storytelling, whether you're binge-watching it all, as you say, over a couple of days, or whether you're waiting and building up that anticipation and excitement for the next episode.
That was all Netflix.
Yeah.
They didn't really open that one up to us. That was they really very confident. Actually, it was also that we were available to be streamed, I think, 4 days before the election, the American election.
Oh yeah.
And I remember being very concerned about that, and I remember sort of saying to them, "This is a catastrophic. Do you have any idea? This is a catastrophic mistake you're making. You want, you're sort of hoping to create water cooler television, and yet you want us to go out 4 days before the biggest water cooler event on the planet?"
Yeah.
And they just looked and smiled and said, "Don't worry, it'll be fine." And I said, "How can it be fine?" And they said, "Because you're thinking analog, and you're a Jurassic wreck from England." And shut up. And I went, "Oh, okay."
And they were right, weren't
they? They were absolutely right. That actually
the critical reception was great, was it, immediately?
Yeah, but above all, people, the tsunami that was Donald Trump didn't stop people watching in the way that I had anticipated. I thought that we would be sucked right out of the news sphere, and that no newspaper would be being, no arts pages were being read that week. But they were absolutely right. For some reason, we still managed to pop through, and they know their business.
Taryn on Twitter asks, how much of a factor was the budget during the writing? Did it give you more scope, this allegedly enormous budget?
Yes, I wrote in gold. And every now and then I just would eat caviar.
And that's where the budget went.
And that, yes, and the rest of it we made on a very average television budget. No. I think you know, I wrote, I tend to write stuff and then expect the producers to tell me what they can't afford.
Mm. So they could, you're prepared for them to say there won't be an elephant?
Oh, yeah. The elephant was Stephen Daldry's idea.
Was it?
Well, yes. Stephen Daldry behaves as though we have three times the budget that we actually have. And therefore, you know, so it's really, the artists, it's their duty to be irresponsible children and to push the boundaries. And then it's the duty of the producers to push back and tell us what, you know, to impose limitations and curfews and barriers. And
so Stephen hired an elephant, did he?
Well, he didn't hire an elephant. Did he? Get me an elephant. We did go and that was a real elephant.
Have you done anything irresponsible, Philip, with the budget?
Constantly.
Yes, quick.
Although I have to say the anointing oil for the...
Oh, yeah. What for was the, it?
It was from... Tesco Express in Elstree.
What was it? Olive oil.
It was the finest range.
It was the finest range. Yeah, but it was. It was.
Yeah.
Some questions at the front.
Wondered if you could just tell us a little bit about the casting process. That everyone was so good.
Yeah. Nina Gold.
Nina Gold. Mm. Yeah.
Nina Gold's our casting director, who's wonderful, and you tend not to argue with her.
And it had to start with the Queen, didn't it? It had to start with Elizabeth.
That took finding Claire Foy took a while because, you know, we met a number of people and then the minute Claire Foy spoke, we sort
that
of...
that amazing stillness.
Yes, it was that. It was the stillness. Absolutely.
She's so wonderful. She's going to have such a wonderful career. No, really, I sort of look forward to what... You know, I look forward to the next 30 or 40 years, you know, just watching her just become...
But was it always going to be Matt? No,
we met a number of Phillips, and then Matt and Claire together, I saw the two of them together, and then, in fact, I behaved like an irresponsible child. I gave Andy, the producer, no choice. I said, because Andy said, Matt's agent's being a little tricky. I would really appreciate some leverage. And I said, I'm afraid I can't give you any. He's the only one. I want him. He's the only one. He's the one. And so, unfortunately, I think we had to pay Matt.
But then we...
What did he ask?
But the slightly more difficult one for us, which was a brilliant, brilliant, brilliant bit of guidance from Nina Gold, was Churchill and John Lithgow, because that we felt was... We can't cast one of the most iconic British characters in history as an American. And somehow... She was absolutely right to lead us towards that decision. And
well, that did give difficulties to me because I had to make the door of 10 Downing Street 9 inches taller.
Because he's such
so
a tall man.
Every subsequent prime minister has to be taller than the real person.
Yeah.
So you're going to have a giant playing Macmillan?
No.
Well, just put him on stilts every time he goes through the door. You know, we might stretch the budget lowering the door.
Can you do a new door? Yeah. Mm. Some more questions, please. The lady at the back, the woman at the back, as David Dimbleby says.
Hi, it's a question for Philip and for Martin. The Crown is one of the few series that Netflix, well, one of the first series that Netflix has released in UHD. Ultra high definition. I wondered how much do you have to take that into account when you're actually making the show?
I was just fortunate to get my first choice of painter. You know, it's really as simple as that. And my first choice of construction people and set decorators. And so, you know, that level of detail is that if it's there for the naked eye, then it's there for that level of HD.
And we use, as lots of people do, but we... whole set of vintage lenses, so in a way we have very high definition 4K raw footage, and then we try in effect optically to not to degrade it but to shoot it through lenses that are 50 60 years old, just to de-digitalize the end result. And we use a lot of things like smoke and so on, just to sort of
just to soften off the vista, if you like. Often with 4K or with very high ultra definition things, everything's pixel perfect from right in front of your nose to a million miles away. And so we're just trying to get the light and the lenses and everything to fall off photographically, as it would do when if you were shooting on a camera 50 years ago.
So you have a bit of water vapor in the air sometimes.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Just so that things fall off, and not everything's not perfect. And some, but it does subject the Martin's work to incredible scrutiny, and that's why like everything, like the painting, everything has to be amazing basically, because you're going to see it all.
Yeah, and I never know when that falling off is going to happen.
No, exactly. So
I have to
sometimes
be prepared for not falling off.
No, exactly. Yeah. Sometimes something that you think is not going to be in the middle of the frame turns out to be the one thing that you want to focus on.
Yeah.
So but it's something we're very conscious of, and particularly with a story that has so much mystery and magic to it, in some ways you want it not to feel, you want it to feel like that, and not to feel too real in a way.
Martin, how did you get the mist on the Wolverton Chase, the morning mist? It's a beautiful effect.
Special effects pumping mist into the... Unfortunately, it was a very still day.
Yeah.
It was a very still day, and we kind of woke up to a mistiness that day as well, so we kind of had God on our side.
He approved. Another question from over there, maybe. That lady there, woman there. Okay. I was actually thinking of somebody else, but... we're all equal before the crime.
What can you tell us about season two, or series two?
That's also a question from Ruana on Facebook.
Spoiler alert. Yeah.
The season continues exactly from where we left off. So the years that it travels are, I think, 1956 to 1964. And it's, you know, it's the same... It's, you know, it's Claire Foy again as the Queen and Matt Smith. So it takes them to what I think are the outer edge of where we can take them with their ages without, you know, I think if we go any further, we'll probably be thinking about recasting so that we can take the character and make the character older and go into the future. But there's no commitment to going further at the moment. We're just focusing on this season, and this season takes us through to 1964.
When do you hear if you've been recommissioned for a third season?
Well, you know, we're always we're talking to them all the time, but I think we just want to see how the second season goes. And we're pretty swamped at the moment. I
mean, you haven't started writing the third.
I've started thinking about it, because you have to obviously think, you have to be responsible. You can't then say, oh, I'll do it, and then suddenly go, actually, I've had a look and it's really dull. So I have done some preparatory work, and I'd be happy to do it, but at the moment I'm swamped with what we're doing.
But then you would recast, would you?
I think at the end of 1964, the Queen's got to 38, Claire is 31, 32 years old. And obviously, any subsequent season would go from 1964 to wherever, the mid-70s, say. Mm. And then you're starting to think about a woman in her 50s, and that's, at 50. And you couldn't really ask Claire to do that.
But there's a danger, isn't there, that people will switch on whatever you do with Netflix and say, well, that's not my Queen.
Well, we've got to do our job properly then, because actually what we need them to do is go, how interesting.
Yeah, exactly.
This is, I'm happy for this to be my Queen. Mm-hmm. If they reject it and they're entitled to, then we've messed up.
The woman I disappointed, which I have a habit of doing.
Disappointed lady at the back. My question was really from a storytelling perspective. What was the unique opportunity that Netflix provided you in telling the story and letting it unfold, given you knew it would be released as a box set, as multiple episodes, and the singular view being enabled to kind of manifest itself? And how did you sort of stop yourself indulging? And how did you kind of hold yourself back from actually going too far down one lane, as it were, the schedule providing you with a bit more of a confines for how you tell a story? The fact you didn't have those creative boundaries, how far that was a blessing and a curse.
It's interesting because, you know, for example, they have no limitation for, so they say as long as you deliver us something that's about 51, 52 minutes, we don't mind. You know, if you can let your episodes run wherever you want. I'm pretty fascistic about this, and I really, I think something, I think that I want the episodes to run at about 53 minutes. So I actually end up, I do think less is more. I think you can become quite indulgent, you can let stories run and drift, and I don't think anyone thanks you for it. And so that is a self-imposed confinement. Mm. I'm enormously liberated by Netflix in a couple of ways. The first, by their boundless confidence and their sense that the very company that has commissioned us represents a new future which none of us quite know where it's taking us. And that galvanizes me and inspires me enormously at a time where, you know, on a project which could easily be too traditional. So there's something quite old schooly and traditional about the show, and yet something about Netflix's modernity I found incredibly helpful and inspiring.
You can share that something you wouldn't have done had you been commissioned for ITV or the BBC.
I wouldn't have said the C word on page three.
apart from strong language and scenes of sexual nature, you know, are there things you thought I wouldn't necessarily have allowed an episode to breathe that particular story and allowed it to have an entire episode? Or
well, possibly not. Possibly I, you know, I self-censor and I am quite conventional in what I do. You know, in that, like, for example, I don't like Baz Luhrmann did a show and the opening episode was 90 minutes, and I wouldn't do that. I mean, that's just not my taste. But I don't know. I feel liberated by them, and that all I can tell you is that translates into how I feel when I'm writing, how I feel when I get up in the morning. I feel completely supported and liberated. And every time I ring them up with an issue, their response is progressive and open-minded. There are so many times that you deal with broadcasters, commissioners, and they have legions of sort of, you know, script editors that sort of crush you with notes. And they have. This is almost like that brief era in Hollywood where they let, you know, filmmakers run a studio. And I feel incredibly responsible. I'm sort of schwitz much more than I would do normally because I don't want to ruin this gig for subsequent other writers and directors, because I am, Philip will attest to this, I'm really committed to reaching final cut on every episode in complete partnership with the director on our own in an executive-free zone. Where else does that happen? In any medium, film or in television, we reach final cut with a director and a writer in partnership. Yeah. It's kind of heavenly, right? And I think that starts, the trickle down of that starts with Netflix. They don't micromanage, they don't interfere, which means that if they trust me, I can then say, right, I want to do it this way. And if we, as soon as we mess up, they'll jump in. I promise they will.
But I remember an early viewing, actually, I mean, we were locked by them, but we showed them episode 10, Philip's episode of season one, and we showed them the end. Do you remember? We showed it quite spontaneously. We were watching, I think, an earlier. Anyway, we were with all the big execs from Netflix. They'd flown over from LA. And Peter suddenly said, oh, I really want to show a bit of this. Just watch a bit of this. And we'd seen it, and we were really, really excited. And so they sat there, and I was watching it sort of through their eyes, and I was thinking, God, it's quite dark. The storm clouds are coming. Eden's jacket, you know, it's NASA. It's all, you know, marriage is in decline, and it's all really, really discordant and dark. And we're ending a season like that. And I suddenly thought, shit, okay, are they, you know? And I remember we all went out afterwards, and I said. And they said, oh, we love it like that. That's fantastic. It's bold. It's brilliant. You've written. It's coming from a real place. And I just thought, bravo, great, fantastic.
I'm going to have to be a time fascist myself because we've kind of come to the end. I know Fraser's going to say a few words, but I really want to thank you. I said you lot were jewels, and you've
truly sparkled tonight. Terribly grateful. Thank you very much.
Thank you.